In this video, we take a look at the data processing necessary to train causal language models. Causal language modeling is the task of predicting the next token based on the previous ones. Another term for causal language modeling is autoregressive modeling. In the example that you can see here, the next token could, for example, be NLP, or it could be machine learning. A popular example of causal language models is the GPT family of models. To train models such as GPT, we usually start with a large corpus of text files. These files can be web pages scraped from the internet, such as the Common Crawl dataset, or they can be Python files from GitHub, like the ones you can see here. As a first step, we need to tokenize these files, such that we can feed them through the model. Here we show the tokenized texts as bars of various length, illustrating that they are shorter and longer ones. This is very common when working with text. However, transform models have a limited context window, and depending on the data source, it is possible that the tokenized texts are much longer than this window. In this case, we could just truncate the sequences to the context length, but this would mean that we lose everything after the first context window. Using the return overflow in token flag, we can use the tokenizer to create chunks, with each one being the size of the context length. Sometimes it can still happen that the last chunk is too short if there aren't enough tokens to fit it. In this case, we can just remove it. With the return length keyword, we also get the length of each chunk from the tokenizer. This function shows all the steps necessary to prepare the dataset. First, we tokenize the dataset with the flags I just mentioned. Then we go through each chunk, and if its length matches the context length, we add it to the inputs we return. We can apply this function to the whole dataset. In addition, we make sure that to use batches and remove the existing columns. We need to remove the existing columns because we can create multiple samples per text, and the shapes in the datasets would not match anymore in that case. If the context length is of similar length as the files, this approach doesn't work so well anymore. In this example, both sample 1 and 2 are shorter than the context size and would be discarded with the previous approach. In this case, it is better to first tokenize each sample without truncation, and then concatenate the tokenized samples with an end of string or EOS token in between. Finally, we can chunk this long sequence with the context length, and we don't lose too many sequences because they're too short anymore. So far, we have only talked about the inputs for causal language modeling, but not the labels needed for supervised training. When we do causal language modeling, we don't require any extra labels for the input sequences, as the input sequences themselves are the labels. In this example, when we feed the token trans to the model, the next token we want it to predict is formers. In the next step, we feed trans and formers to the model, and the label we want it to predict is R. This pattern continues, and as you can see, the input sequences is the label sequence just shifted by one. Since the model only makes predictions after the first token, the first element of the input sequence, in this case trans, is not used as a label. Similarly, we don't have a label for the last token in the sequence, since there is no token after the sequence ends. Let's have a look at what we need to do to create the labels for causal language modeling in code. If we want to calculate a loss on a batch, we can just pass the input IDs as labels, and all the shifting is handled in the model internally. So you see, there is no matching involved in processing data for causal language modeling, and it only requires a few simple steps.